It seems to me nearly everybody believes in free will. It seems to be the natural state of the human mind. It's also natural and in many different cultures, not just ours with our language. We feel ourselves to be a ghost in the machine, somebody inside the body who is making it work, not just that we are the body or the product of a machine. And given that feeling, it's natural that people believe in free will. I think believing in free will is being deluded. The whole point about this sense of freedom is that I feel as if I can make the decisions. There's somehow some little me inside here who's the one who experiences a stream of consciousness and who makes the decisions. Now, this has to be an illusion. The more we learn about the brain, and we're learning more and more all the time, the less room there is for a little person in there. And anyway, the brain doesn't even have a middle where the self could be. It doesn't work like stuff comes in, I experience it, and then I make a decision. It's just not like that. So the self who would have free will has to be an illusion, I think. We are deluded about ourselves and about our power. Actually, we're just little specks in a big universe, and we don't really have that power. One of the most famous experiments, well, the most famous experiment ever done on questions of volition and free will, was done by the neuroscientist Benjamin Libet back in the mid-80s. And he only had electroencephalogram then to measure what's going on in the brain, not brain scans. But by measuring activity on the scalp here over the motor cortex, you can detect what's called a readiness potential, which is the brain getting itself ready for an action. And what he wanted to prove was that when you act, and he chose a simple action, just flipping the wrist like this, and his subjects had to choose of their own volition, of their own free will, when to move. He believed that their conscious decision, that he called W for will, was the cause of the movement. And others said, well, it's the brain activity that's the cause. And so he wanted to do an experiment to time them. Now, it's very easy to time brain activity and movement, and it's very difficult to time when you have the conscious decision to move. But he did that by having a spot revolving, and the subjects, when they were doing this, had to say where the spot was at the moment that they decided to move. And in that way, he was able to ask the question, which comes first, the decision to move or the start of the brain activity? And to his horror, he discovered that the decision to move seems to come about 200 milliseconds, a fifth of a second, before the action, whereas the start of brain activity is about half a second, more than twice as long, before the action. It starts a long way before we get the desire to move. There are many, many ways of interpreting this and huge philosophical problems, but the basic finding is absolutely solid. It's been repeated again and again, and more recently with brain scans and with all sorts of variations with more complicated actions. And there's no question about it. All this stuff is bubbling up. And this feeling that, oh, now I'm going to decide, is just part of the whole process, not the beginning that Libet wanted it to be. So we have experiences all the time in our everyday life of we think of doing something and then the action happens. So we jump to the false conclusion that the thought caused the action. In fact, the thought and the action are both consequences of a mass of complicated stuff going on in a complicated brain and body in a complicated world. When people start to think that maybe there really is no free will, one of the biggest fears is that, well, if I stop believing in free will, I'll go and do something terrible. I'll be wicked. Deep, deep worry that people have is that somehow our whole legal system will collapse. That somehow, if there's no free will, then we can't punish people for doing terrible things. But this, I think, is completely misguided. You would still, for example, lock people up in prison if they were a danger to the society. You would still lock people up or make them pay fines or do work or some other thing if it would help either to change their behavior in the future or to deter other people from behaving badly in the future. All of that would remain. The poison devils, see, they don't give a fuck about you like I do. We don't need to fear that all hell would break loose if we started to throw off the delusion of free will. I think there are really three general reactions to evidence that suggests there isn't free will or arguments that suggest that free will is a delusion. And they are, one, shut your eyes and hope the problem will go away. The second reaction is to say, well, maybe free will is an illusion, but I must live as if there's free will. So you kind of live with this sort of conflict. There was nobody I talked to in those interviews who has taken the path that I have, which is to say, if it's not true, I've got to rearrange my entire thinking about myself and my life and everything that this thing here does in order to face that truth. It's a bit like the dance of Shiva, really. We're not separate from the universe. We're just part of this wonderful ongoing flow. I think most people just assume there's free will and assume that everybody else assumes there's free will and assumes that the whole of our society and our culture and our legal systems depend on free will, and they don't want to question it. It's too difficult to throw it off.